So the main symptoms and signs of dyspraxia, if that's the umbrella term we're going to use, or the international term, DCD, are those fine motor problems. So at home, they have problems maybe getting dressed and cleaning their teeth, wiping your bottom, getting dressed, doing your buttons up, doing your shoelaces up. When you go down for breakfast, then using cutlery might be difficult, so your child might be a bit of a messy eater. Using a knife and fork, which is a two-handed activity, can be really quite difficult to do. Getting a spoon and not spilling when you're pouring a drink, that's quite a complex task. You've got to hold the jug and pour it into the cup, so that can be quite difficult. Sitting still and balancing on the chair, so even though you're sitting, it's still a balancing task. You need to balance and hold your cutlery. And then when you're going off to school, in school that can be really difficult because there's lots of tasks in school that require good coordination. So you've got to be able to carry your bag on your back and be able to unpack your bag and get your books out. You need to unzip the pencil case. You need to be able to write in class and keep up to speed with other children. And writing is a real problem, usually for young people who have dyspraxia. Learning to write, keeping the writing on the line, making sure that it's properly spaced, making the right shape so your letters are nice and consistent. Those are things that are really difficult. And then keeping up to speed as you get older, keeping up to speed with your peers. So when everybody else is copying down from the board, your child might actually find that that's much harder to do and get behind. And then sometimes get into trouble because of that, because they haven't copied down what they should off the board and then feel frustrated. So that's a secondary consequence, that feeling of frustration. So writing, and then in sport, you've got a whole myriad of things that can be a problem for a child with dyspraxia. So from getting changed, so when you go and get changed in the changing room, you've got to take your shoes off and you've got to put your football boots on. So tying your shoelaces might be difficult. And you might find that your child does tie their shoelaces, but they always fall apart. They never sort of stay done up. And then getting your top on the right way round and being slower getting to PE or getting to football. Everybody's there and your child might be the one that's missed some of the instructions because they've been late. So again, the secondary consequences of having a motor problem, they get into trouble because they're late because they've been slower getting changed. And then when they get to PE, understanding the rules of the game, so especially in team games, is going to be really hard for a child with dyspraxia quite often. They've got to, if you're playing football, you've got to be able to run around the pitch, listen to the instructions, be able to predict where the ball's coming from, which could be any direction, and then decide where you're going to kick the ball, and you've got to look around and see where the other players are. And so in a large pitch as well. So that's really difficult. So team games particularly are going to be harder, and children seem to be much better with dyspraxia doing smaller games where they might be one-on-one, or swimming where they're not in direct competition or having to do the timing that they require, that they need to do for team sports. And then at the end of the day, you've got to take and write down your homework. And so kids have got writing problems. First of all, feel much more tired because they're going to have to work much harder than other children. And then when they get home, they may not have had the right written the right homework down. So they're going to feel pretty frustrated. And that other children will pick up and notice that a child with coordination difficulty looks different to them. And so it may be that they find it harder to make friends and keep friends. So when they come home and they've got to do their homework, they may not have the same network of friends as other children that don't have these sort of difficulties. So they get into trouble again because they can't do all their homework, but they don't know who to call. And so socially, we see that children with dyspraxia may well be more socially isolated and harder to keep friends, which is really hard because most children with dyspraxia will be average or above average intelligence. And so they will have the insight from the age of 6 or 7 often to realise they're different from their peers. And sometimes we avoid talking about a diagnosis, but often the child themselves knows that they're really different from their peers. And I think it's important to talk about what the child can't do, but also what the child can do. That's really important. But frame it in the frame of, well, I can do this, but I can't do that. Your father can't do this, but he can do that. In the same way that your child might be able to do some things, but not others. So it's not seen as a disabled label. The child is a child with dyspraxia, not a dyspraxic child, and that's really important. When you're thinking about whether your child has got motor difficulties, which would fit a criteria for dyspraxia, I think one of the important things is enduring and pervasive, and that's the two words that are really important. that lots of people can't do lots of things, and so you may find you're not very good at kicking, catching a ball. You may not be slower learning some of the skills, but it's the pattern, which is first of all, is that your child might find that they have difficulties learning a number of different skills, not just one skill. So that they may have difficulties with writing, with dressing, with cutlery, with ball skills, with moving around in their moving environment. And it's that over a period of time, so that when other children have learnt these skills, so I wouldn't expect a child of 3 to ride a bike, but I would expect a child of 8 or 9 to have learnt to ride a bike. So there is a developmental variation that some skills that some children just take a bit longer to learn, but they're not abnormal. And some children find they find it much harder to learn, even when they've got past an age when you would expect children to have done those and learned those skills competently. So is your child having difficulty learning skills that you would have expected him or her to have learned by an age where everybody else has already learned them? So things like riding a bike, feeding yourself, you'd expect a 6-year-old to be able to use a knife and fork reasonably competently. Is your child still struggling doing those sort of things? So enduring, is it continuing to be a problem? And then pervasive is the second bit, which is your child having problems more than one area, at home and at school? And if you think about coordination difficulties, well, there isn't much that affects you. It affects every part of your life, from getting up in the morning to going to bed at night. You need to be able to be coordinated to function. So if your child has got difficulties at home and at school, so it's pervasive, it's in more than one setting, and it's enduring, it's lasting over a period of time, then that means it's more likely they have that diagnosis.